Those are supporters crowding outside Hariri's house, thrilled with his announcement today that his resignation is on hold. This is just the latest twist in a political drama that began earlier this month, and it has implications far beyond Lebanon.
أعلن استقالتي من رئاسة الحكومة اللبنانية.
The announcement was a surprise, the conditions mysterious. There are suggestions Lebanese Prime Minister Saad Hariri was held hostage by the Saudis and his resignation forced to destabilize Lebanon's government. Allegations Riyadh denies, but here's where they're believable. Hariri is a Saudi citizen. Riyadh backs his political party, but his coalition government includes Hezbollah, a Shia Islamist movement supported by Iran, and that's the crux. Iran and Saudi Arabia are bitter rivals, and there's speculation Lebanon was just a political pawn in a Saudi power play. Arnala Ayed is in Beirut. She looks at Hariri's return and the decision to suspend his resignation.
At 74 years since independence, the low-key milestone would still call for a military parade in the presence of Lebanon's vast array of VIPs. But it might have passed unnoticed had it not been for Saad Hariri. Along with some big unanswered questions about his absence, his first full day back also brought some clarity. For one, that despite the warm welcome, he had indeed come back to officially resign in person instead of from Saudi Arabia.
It's a relief. Not only a relief, it's a step forward. It doesn't matter if he wants to resign or stay, but at least he's doing this in Lebanon.
But having later gone to the president, as the Constitution requires, offering to resign, he held off on the request of the president, but only temporarily, Hariri says, to allow for dialogue. Hariri insists Lebanon must remain regionally neutral. Comments aimed at his coalition partners, Iran-backed Hezbollah, deeply involved in Syria and Iraq's conflicts, and also supportive of Hariri since he vanished because he made the coalition government possible. His strategy now, after the French president's apparent mediation, seems to buy time on a sensitive matter that could, as in the past, lead to conflict with Hezbollah. Hariri's strategy may not be popular in Riyadh, popular as it might be among the supporters who gathered to welcome Hariri home.
We are very, very happy to see him amongst us. He is the essence of our life here in Lebanon. We can't live without him.
For a country often at the mercy of dangerous regional battles, Hariri's return on Independence Day holds huge symbolic value. But his long way home through France, Egypt, and Cyprus suggests Lebanon's dependence on outside powers endures.
Nala joins us now from Beirut. Nala, if Hezbollah is so opposed to Hariri, then why isn't it satisfied with him just resigning and being out of the country?
Well, because Saad Hariri is specifically the prime minister who, A, made it possible for Hezbollah to have its preference for a president actually be elected last year, and B, to actually build a coalition government that ended more than 2 years of political chaos. So they have what they want, and they want to protect it. And it's why you heard the other day the head of Hezbollah, Hassan Nasrallah, actually saying that not only does he demand Hariri coming back, but that he was open to having a dialogue with him.
So I think we've all learned over the years that, you know, what happens in Lebanon tends to ripple. What's your read of the danger here regionally?
Well, as you say, it's quite simple. What happens in Lebanon tends to mirror regional tensions. So if Hariri walks out, that is a signal that the two regional powers are seriously at odds. And a new confrontation on top of what already exists could be quite dangerous and costly. And we know already that an untold number of lives have been claimed in that rivalry. Adrian.
Okay. Nala, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
As Nahla explained, what's happening in Lebanon is actually less about Lebanon than the big powers of Iran and Saudi Arabia, and that Saudi sense that just maybe Iran is flexing too much power. Its influence is growing in Iraq and Syria at a time when Saudi Arabia sees little but trouble, a catastrophic war in Yemen, dropping oil revenues, and the Saudis can't stand the idea of being seen as weak. The new crown prince is trying some new moves. So what's he really up to? Mohammed bin Salman's strategy is quick and ruthless. Earlier this month, mere hours after the creation of an anti-corruption task force, he arrested some wealthy and powerful Saudis, including blood relatives. Their jail, the Riyadh Ritz-Carlton. Fitting, given the estimated $800 billion of net worth held captive inside. Generally, Saudi citizens don't have a problem cutting the elite down to size. They know it's corrupt at the top. And as a young, growing, hungry-to-work population, they want a piece of the prosperity. And that's where Mohammed bin Salman, or MBS as he's known, comes in. He is the millennial reformer, loosening the rules around concerts and movie theaters. On women attending events.
Shukrani, Baba.
And yes, letting women drive. The strategy of that in this Coke ad. Change is good, it claims, playing right into what MBS wants.
This is sort of a shock therapy. It was a shock to the world to say, look, Saudi Arabia means business. We're not just gonna talk off of a beautiful blueprint, we're gonna actually execute it.
A trade advisor and former diplomat, Omar Alam, sees opportunity for Canada in this. He says Saudi Arabia invests around $3 billion here every year, and there's room for more the other way.
Canada's trade agenda is all about diversification, going into new markets. So if the kingdom could be used as a market, it's strategic from a Canadian's perspective, but it's also very high risk.
One of the big risks, having one man controlling all the levers of power.
This is a very inexperienced, dynamic, aggressive, bold, very young man of 32 years old. This autocratic power grab that he's engineering now with success so far inside Saudi Arabia is a dangerous signal, because it's really telling us that Saudi Arabia is now going to become a very centralized power state in which total power in all spheres of life is held in the hands of one person.
And frankly, the whole strategy could backfire. He may want and get new investment, but the brutality of his purge, of that vicious war in Yemen, are stains that might be hard to erase.